Exactly. This is the cell soup, and this big motor up here is kind of like a blender. It's just spinning these cells around and agitating them to make sure that they're as evenly distributed throughout the vessel as possible.
The container is a bioreactor, a kind of super crockpot, and you'll find plenty of them, of varying sizes, holding different combinations of cell soup in the labs of Biogen.
So a cell can make any number of proteins.
Brandon Moore is a kind of cell chef who cooks the soup.
What cells do best is divide, and we want to make sure that they're in the correct environment to divide. So this bioreactor gives the cells everything they need to grow and to live. Just like all the cells in your body or my body, we need these cells to be in the correct pH environment, not too acidic, not too basic. We need them to have oxygen because these cells respire just like our cells do. And additionally, they need to have all the nutrients they need to make our proteins and to live.
Biogen operates one of the largest cell culture facilities in the world in Research Triangle Park. The company makes biologic molecules, which are composed of sugars, proteins, nucleic acids, and other complex combinations. These molecules are turned into medicines. While many medicines, such as aspirin, are simple chemical combinations produced in a lab, the molecules of biological medicines are large and complicated. So researchers turn to nature. That's right, in the world of biologics, it's the cells in the soup that make the products.
In this case, the drug is not the cell, but rather the cells make the drug and then they throw it out of their membranes into the media. So they will secrete this drug into the cell culture media. What we end up with at the end of the process is a mixture of cells, proteins that the cells made that we don't want, and the protein that the cells made that we do want.
Okay.
And the tricky part is dividing those.
Think of a recipe. Once a molecule is identified to treat a disease, cells must be convinced to make it. So, the genome of the cell is modified to produce the desired molecule, or future medicine. Meanwhile, a cell matrix, or a soup, which will keep the cells alive and preserve the special molecules the cells are making, is also prepared. Once the cells are in the matrix and producing the desired molecules, the mix must be purified to remove everything but the desired cells. If it all works, the process is expanded to increase production. So, what started in a dish in a lab is gradually increased to produce thousands of gallons, all while still having the desired therapeutic effect on a disease.
So essentially the product quality attributes are kind of signatures of the molecule and saying that this molecule is what we say it is, you know, based on like these specific product quality attributes being within a certain range. Over time, you know, as we're trying to reap sort of economies, as we start going through that manufacturing process more, we want to go back into the development lab, tinker with the molecule some more, say, can we, you know, beat it up a little bit and get it to produce more, you know, over that same period of time than it was producing before.
There is so much going on inside the bioreactors, and it is so sensitive that what is happening is monitored constantly. These are probes, one for pH or the acidity of the solution, one for dissolved oxygen. Those are feeding data into computers. And then every day, these bags are used to take a sample of the solution. That also will be analyzed.
Things change drastically as you scale up, and there are so many ways you can think about the differences in the scale. So there are certainly the chemical environment. Things like aeration becomes very complicated.
And then there's the challenge of turning the molecule into actual medicine that can be delivered to a patient.
And one big one is how to maintain stability, because now this molecule needs to be in some sort of matrix that allows it to stay in a perfect, if it's an antibody formation. It also needs to be in a chemical environment that can be delivered to a human.
We're making a protein in a non-human host that we can purify and inject into a patient. And the patient's body sees that protein as a friendly protein and uses the protein to perform some kind of healing function or some kind of therapeutic function. It's amazing.